well over a month since I started pulling on this chip, but we're finally back with the pile of Commodore 64, and this is exhibit C that we're going to finish today. And as you saw in the previous episode, we're starting with the CIA chip that I actually got a new one, new old stock from somewhere in Europe. More precisely, somewhere in the Brexit area. And the legs on this chip are actually still in its factory position. It hasn't been bent in to fit the socket, so it looks like it's new. The cardboard in this computer goes away, and we're gonna run the dead test cartridge to make sure that the time of day clocks are running, which means that the CIA chips are both working. So let's see what happens. So is the suspense killing you? Because it really shouldn't. I mean, it's just a computer. But hey, yeah. The time of day clock seems like it's running fine, and that is a good clue that the CIA chip is running fine. So we can continue on. Into the second diagnostic cartridge now, and it's still running fine. But to continue here, we will need the keyboard. And I will use this keyboard that was probably the original for this board, actually. Because the print on the keys look like it should on the Commodore 64 with the short ports. So let's plug it in and see. Alright, I want some key presses here, and well, the CIA chip that we replaced is actually responsible for controlling the keyboard, so this will be a definite proof that this is running fine. And it looks great. Awesome. Sound test won't work. Sound test doesn't work because we have no SID chip. And finding a SID chip is not as easy as finding a CIA or any other chip in this computer, because the SID chips, they die. And they have died from heat, and they have died from overvoltage and everything over the years. So our hope, just as with the PLA chip, is to turn to a modern day replacement that's basically emulates the original chip. And I got this package. This is a little bit of a mystery package, because it also has a long cable and some diodes and a resistor in here. And I'm going to explain why in a little while. But first we go through this this card and see what's happening on it. We replaced the CIA chip here, of course. We have, as you see, the VIC chip is not in here, and that's because I am planning to put a LumaFix64 between the VIC chip and the board. This is because the short boards, and specifically these VIC chips on this model, has a way of leaking digital signals into the analog circuit. So the LumaFix sort of adds on and inverts those digital signals to counteract that problem. And as a SID chip, I will use the ARM2SID. It's a SID emulator built on an ARM chip, as the name suggests, and it can actually emulate two SID chips, even three SID chips. And that's why we have this extra cable to connect to the extra address lines that's needed to address the second emulated SID chip. And the ARM2SID is very configurable. It can listen to a number of different addresses for the second and third SID chip. It automatically switches between stereo and mono, and it can also emulate the SFX sound expander cartridge containing an FM synthesizer together with a SID chip. So let's go ahead and wire up the cable that is needed to get all these address lines into the ARM2SID. Some of them will need to come from the CPU, some of them comes from the cartridge port, and the manual is very nice and very detailed, and runs nicely on an iPad or any other tablet of your choice. I will refrain from going into religious discussions. Anyway, let's wire this up and hope everything works. There is also a cable that, or a wire, sorry, not a cable. There is a wire that goes to the audio video port in the back. And I'm going to use pin 7 for the second sound channel. It's not used for anything, so we don't risk frying anything. Anyway, I should make lunch. Well, later. Wiring in the ARM2SID chip like this is not the only way to do it. I mean, we could just plug it in here and use it as a single SID chip straight away. It will work, and this is only needed if you want the stereo SID and the multiple SID and the FM emulation to work. And if you already have a dual SID setup, you can buy the ARM2SID with a second board and a cable between them that plugs in both the SID sockets and actually uses just whatever stereo SID modification you already have there to wire it in. But here it is, two cables to the processor. As you see, I taped them down a bit to make them look a bit more tidy. There are some cables that goes to the back to the audio video socket, and a couple of cables that goes to the cartridge port. And these diodes and resistors here on the cartridge port help us reach all the possible combinations of dual SID and sound expander cartridges that exist, so that this is actually compatible with pretty much any software hardware setup that you would want to emulate. So that's it. We'll mount the board, and there's actually one thing we're going to have some issues with here, because the LumaFix that is mounted under the VIC chip is going to lift the VIC chip a bit too high, and that's gonna cause the keyboard to press against the VIC chip. And I guess it's not that big of an issue, but I don't like the idea of something pressing against that one. It needs some air circulation, and there's going to be some mechanical stress on the board also. I think we're better off just trying to cut out a little bit of the plastic. On this model, the newest model with the short boards, the keyboard actually snaps into the top lid, so there are no mounts and screws and brackets and stuff on the board. So we'll need to snap this in here, and we will place it on top of the bottom, and we'll see if we can identify exactly where we need to cut the plastic to get it clear from the VIC. I'll replace the missing feet here also, and then we'll try to shine in and see how badly this touches. Yeah, we can definitely see that this the plastic from the top lid is pressing very hard on the VIC. So I'll take a marker pen, and I will see if I can find the position of the where the cuts will need to be made. That should be fairly clear, and I'll mark this up a bit clearer, and then I will Dremel it out and try to destroy it in a controlled manner. All right, that should do it. Lining it up with the case, and yeah, I think that'll do nicely. Nothing touching. Cool. What next? I'm not the fan of replacing capacitors just because you need to replace capacitors, just because you need to replace them. I need a better reason than that, and Right now, I'm going against my beliefs. Of course, we're talking about specifically the electrolytic capacitors. And if you're going to replace them, you should replace them with something that is better quality than what you're actually removing. Because there is a big chance that if you're buying a replacement kit or a recap kit from anywhere, you're going to get a quality that is a bit questionable. And the original ones, if they are still fine, you might even risk downgrading the reliability of the computer if you're replacing fair quality capacitors that are old with dodgy quality capacitors that are new. So I believe that it's better to check the capacitors. Do they look swollen? Do they look dodgy in any way? Like, you know, do they have a leak? Because, you know, leak is nice. Because usually you're looking at specific positions on the board that are bad. It's in the power supply on the secondary side usually. And in the Commodore 64 specifically, it's around the VIC chip. And when you measure a capacitor, you need to look a little bit more than just on the capacitance value. You also need to see what the equivalent series resistance, the ESR value is. And you also need to see how much voltage loss you get on the charge. And there are very cheap instruments that can do this for you. So just look around eBay and find one. It's going to be worth it. And that means you will only need to replace the capacitors that are actually bad, and then you can use good quality ones to replace them. Next up, we're going to look at the configuration program for the ARM2SID, and I'm going to use the Ribbit Pi 1541 emulator that I built in the last video. And I'm not gonna run from tape. No, I'm gonna load from disk. So I'll start up the file browser and we'll see how the configuration program for the ARM2SID looks. It should be somewhere in the SID folder. Let's test c32.prg. All right then. Here we go. And we can see that there is more than one ARM2SID found, because ARM2SID is the previous version of the chip. ARM2SID is the new version, and it's running on 9 volts, which means that it is running on a short port, and therefore it automatically runs as the new version of the SID chip. Here we can see we can select a triple SID on a specific address, or we can just run with various addresses bound to different left and right configurations. And we can also use a combination of SFX cartridge and SID. But for now, I'll leave it as the default, and we'll load up some SIDs to see how it sounds. And my program of choice for this is SIDPlay64, which is a very nice program to run, for example, the high voltage SID collection that I'll be running now. And I will use the SD2IEC version of the program, because that one is the one that works best, as far as I can find, with the Pi 1541. So to demonstrate a little bit how the ARM2SID switches between mono and stereo, I will first run a stereo file. And then a normal single SID file. And this is one of the quirks with the ARM2SID. If you're running a mono file straight after a stereo file, it takes about 15 seconds before both channels to kick in, because it's waiting for data on the second SID. And when no data is arriving on that channel, it after a while it switches to single SID configuration. And this is really the only flaw I find in the ARM2SID. I would have wanted a way to configure this, but otherwise it's excellent. By the way, that was my kid playing drums. So we're done with exhibit C, and this is This is lovely. I need to fulfill a promise here, because in the beginning of this series I promised that I would look into a specific game, and this is for you, Wendy. I'm going to run Blue Max on my newly renovated Commodore 64, and as you can hear, the SID version of Rule Britannia hasn't aged well at all. Anyway, this will be the end this should have been the end of the pile of Commodore 64s, but actually, over the course of a few weeks, I have managed to source yet another keyboard. Because in the pile that is left now, we have the plastic case and we have a board, but we don't have a keyboard. And that means, with another SID chip and another PLA, we will actually be able to complete 3 out of 3 Commodores of the pile. And I'm very happy about that, actually. It was way more than I thought I would be able to accomplish in the beginning. Now, the case we have now is fairly yellow, and it needs to that needs to be addressed. So I will show you the least, or just let's say logom effort way to make this yellowed case look less yellow without traditional retrobriting. It's a logom effort way, and you're going to like it or hate it. We'll see. So thanks for watching, and be sure to subscribe, and if you want to support my channel, check out my Patreon page. And oh, even in the demo I crash.